We talked about this often. One of the features of, I don't know how to call it, new phase in the world order, where, as you told me, we no longer live in this traditional neoliberal market order and so on and so on. I remember we were talking even on phone. You remember that moment? I think it was in the spring or summer of 2020, when on the almost the same day that the numbers came out from United Kingdom and United States of how the production fell down, stock market went up. And then you say there is something tremendous happening now in capitalism. It's no longer the old market, profit, productivity, and so on.
It's no longer capitalism.
Can you develop this?
Yeah. I'll go back to that date. Thank you for reminding me. It was the 12th of August, 2020. Not that last August, mm-hmm. the previous one. 9 o'clock in the morning in London, the news came out that the national income of Britain, GDP as it's called, had fallen by more than 20%. That had never happened before in the history of capitalism. British GDP falling in 1 year by 21% or so. Never. It was not anticipated. The markets were expecting a fall of 8, 9, 10%, 20%. No one. No one. 15 or 16 minutes later, the stock exchange, the London Stock Exchange, goes up by 3%. There can be no explanation of that along the lines of capitalism, right? One explanation would have been if the markets were already factoring in, expecting a 10% decline, and it was 8%, things were better than expected, so the stock exchange might have gone up. But to expect 10% and to have 20% and the stock exchange to go up, something else was going on. I know what it is. I'll tell you what it is. Since 2008, the great financial crash, capitalism is on a drip feed. It's being kept alive through constant injections of money from the central banks. That has never happened before. It started in 2008. In 1929, it didn't happen. That's why all the banks closed down. So the banking system and the stock exchange had 12 years of getting used to, becoming addicted to, central bank money being pumped their way during difficult moments. So imagine you're a stockbroker in London. You hear the news at 9 o'clock in the morning. Minus 20%. Oh, my God! You think, that's the first thought. Then you think, if I panicked, the guys and girls in the Bank of England, the Central Bank of England, are panicking. So what they're going to do is they're going to print even more billions, and they will give it to me to play in the stock exchange. Buy. So the point I've been developing in my head, and we had a little discussion about this earlier, because I was telling Slavoj that this will be my next book next year. It's my crazy theory that capitalism has already evolved out of itself. It has been transformed into another system. And the reason why I say that is because, for me, capitalism requires two things. Firstly, profit to drive it. It's like, you know, a petrol engine that needs petrol. Capitalism needs profit, private profit to drive it. Capital accumulation, as we Marxists used to say, okay? And the other thing is that exploitation takes place in markets. That's the whole point about capitalism. In feudalism, there was no market exploitation. You had the peasants, they were growing rubbish, wheat and potatoes and cauliflower, I don't know what it is, that they were growing. And then the sheriff, on behalf of the Lord, would come and take half of it, or 60% of it. There was no market. It was just expropriation. It is with the enclosures and the eviction of the peasants, who then become suppliers of labor at any price, that you have the creation of the working class and the labor market. There was no labor market before that. So exploitation takes place through markets, money markets, land markets, house markets, labor markets. But now, after 12 years of the 2008 crisis and beyond, we have the replacement of profit by central bank money, that is the new fuel of the system, of this exploitative system, and the steady encroachment into the space of markets of platforms. Amazon. The moment you go into Amazon or Facebook, the moment you enter Facebook, you're outside of capitalism, you're not in capitalism anymore.
Explain.
Yeah, you go into Facebook, right? Let's say you want to sell your stuff, to you know, advertise your business in Facebook. You go in, you pay, you use your credit card, you pay money to Zuckerberg, and some more people see your advertisements. You go in there to meet your friends. You want to advertise this evening. You go and pay money. One person owns the whole digital space. It is the equivalent of stepping outside in Ljubljana. Imagine, yeah, just science fiction for a moment. Imagine you step out in Ljubljana, on the streets of Ljubljana tonight, and you look around and you think, oh my God, all these buildings belong to one person. Everything that is traded in the shops that I see is controlled by one person who decides what prices are charged, what prices are not charged, who can trade, who can't trade, who can buy, who can't buy. And moreover, imagine that Ljubljana operated like Facebook does or Amazon does, whereby what your eyes see is determined by one person, by the algorithm of one person, who, if he wants you not to see something, you will never see it in that digital space. This is not a market. This is a fiefdom. It's a digital fiefdom. It's a platform. Those platforms make a lot of money. But the rest of the economy, look at companies like Uber, for instance. They've never made a profit, ever. You have private equity. Have you heard of private equity? Do you know what private equity does? They go and they buy a company. Let's say a company that provides health services. It's got doctors and nurses and stuff, private stuff. So they buy the hospital, they buy the company, and then they create two companies. One that owns the buildings and all the fixed assets, and the other that provides the services. And the second company sells the services to the first company. The first company has assets, buildings. So they go to the bank and they get a huge loan using as collateral the buildings of the first company. They take this money and they give it to themselves. They pay themselves. They give it to the shareholders. They pocket it. They put it in their money. Now, this whole company will never have a profit because the second company will owe huge quantities of money to the first company. Therefore, they will never pay any tax because if you have no profits, there's no tax. But the whole point about profitability is coming out. Very soon after that, this is an empty shell. This will go bankrupt. It will die. So platforms are expanding, even in health. Facebook is now privatizing the National Health Service in Britain without anybody knowing. Google is doing the same thing behind the scenes. Mm-hmm. By the way, DiEM25, our movement, is beginning a campaign on Monday in Britain against the surreptitious privatization of the NHS by big tech, close brackets. So you see, platforms are expanding. They are not markets, and markets are shrinking. And central bank money, sovereign money, the defense money, because they are defend, the governments, they have no power, but their printing presses are keeping the system alive. I call this technofeudalism. It's not just a question of curiosity about how the system works. It's also a question of what does this mean for daily lives? What does it mean for all of us? What does it mean for governments? I'll tell you what it means as an economist for a start. It means that none of the fiscal monetary policies that used to work. Because when you platforms replace markets and everything depends on the central bank money, if I make you the head of the European Central Bank tomorrow, you are the most slavish follower of the needs of business. You have no independence. You have no authority. Even if you want to reduce the amount of money, euros, that the ECB prints, you can't do it. The moment you do it, the whole thing will collapse. That's not central bank independence. That's dependence. Our governments are completely in the clasps of the interests of these large fiefdoms, and they have tiny degrees of freedom regarding fiscal policy, regarding redistribution of wealth, when all the wealth is encased and enclosed in the new fiefdoms. But also, and here is something that would be nice to talk a little bit more about. Look, under standard capitalism, you have a working class which is exploited during the working time, and then they go home, and that's time for themselves. Today, you have a proletariat, a working class, which is shrinking, shrinking, shrinking. And increasingly, everybody is producing capital directly for these fiefdoms. Every time you have your phone and you walk around, Google knows where you are, and that enriches the software of Google Maps. It adds your movements, add capital to Google. You're not a shareholder. You don't get shares for that capital. They get it. With the pandemic, we've seen how work and leisure have been completely decoupled, and how with these digital fiefdoms technologies, it is impossible to even escape for a moment the vestiges of work. It follows you. You know, your boss expects you to be checking your app at midnight. You yourself check your app, even if your boss doesn't want you to check your app. You become self-enslaved. And the most important value of liberalism, which is personal sovereignty, goes. Think of the youngsters. You know, I used to be a professor up until a few years ago. I still am in name. But I look at today's youth, and what I find is young people lacking the sovereignty that the liberal democratic system has promised them. I see them, for instance, take on courses that they know are rubbish, just to add to the CV. I see them constantly trying to improve their social ratings in Twitter, in Instagram, because they're selling themselves constantly. They are creating a profile that makes them, because they know that the moment they go in for an interview, that the interviewing panel is going to check their social media profile. So it's a constant struggle to build up a profile along the lines of the expectations of some fictitious future employer. That is slavery. The complete collapse of the private space that liberals value so much. These are the reasons why, for me, techno-feudalism, you know, is such a menace. And the worst part of it is that when I speak of this, do you know who really loathes my thesis more than anybody else? The left. Because we leftists grew up with this ambition that we would bring capitalism down. And here I am telling them that, you know what? We are out of time. Capitalism has brought itself down. And it's been replaced by something far worse, not by socialism. The left does not want to listen to that. They really loathe that message.